I do appreciate that it is not easy for these thoughts to enter the mind of an ordinary person, because nobody in the world thinks like this. Nobody can think like this. Unless that person who attempts to think like this rises above the ordinary human nature characteristic of every person. Right from the beginning, right from your childhood, you have been seeing things in one way, thinking in one way, and interpreting things in one way. All that way is wrong way, according to the requirement of yoga practice. Because of this wrong way adopted in your thinking, feeling, and dealing with things, there is perpetual suffering, agony of mind, frustration of emotions, conflict everywhere, and nobody can be happy. This is so because of the fact I mentioned the other day that the whole world is against you. Because of the fact you are considering the world as an object to be dealt with in some particular manner, you will certainly not like me to deal with you as an object. Would you like to be dealt with by somebody? It is a very, very objectionable word. You want to deal with me in some way. Have I no self-respect? Am I not what I am? How would you like to deal with me? What right have you? This is what the world is telling you. You have imagined almost like the prodigal son of biblical story. The prodigal son wanted to separate himself from the father, from the estate to which he actually belonged. Everyone in this sense is a prodigal son. Our father is this whole universe itself. Call it God if you like. We wanted our own share. Give me what my share is. You are telling everybody, give my share. And you know what happened to the prodigal son. He had to weep and repent and cry and come back to that from where he has separated himself. Can you remember always that you belong to this world and you are not an observer of the world? Can you remember also in the process of the creative evolutionary process of the world came first and you came afterwards. The world is the subject therefore and you are the object if at all you would like to consider yourself as separate from the world. Instead of you regarding the world as an object of your perception, more properly the world should consider you as its object. And it is the subject in the sense that you cannot stand outside it. Can anybody think like this? Anywhere, you go to the marketplace, go to the shop, railway station, bus stand, will anybody like to think like this? Not possible. Because yoga, if you are sincerely aspiring for it, is not intended for a casual person who takes everything lightly. Okay, let it be or let it not be. If it comes, okay. If it doesn't come, that is also all right. This kind of attitude is repugnant to the real and true aspiration for yoga. The brain will refuse to think in the manner required by the practice of yoga. Because as I have mentioned earlier also, this is not the only occasion that you have come to this world. There are layers and layers of planes of existence through which the mortal individual has passed in the process of evolution. In this process you have accumulated varieties of impressions, all which center around the wrong thinking that you are accustomed to. You want something from the world and you do not want to be friendly with the world. If you want something from a person, that person cannot be your friend. The friend is more important than that which the friend is likely to give you. Don't you think that? My friend is more valuable than that which I am expecting from the friend. But we want to grab things from the world. Is this not the whole story of economic life, political life, social life, personal life, emotional life? Why do you want to grab anything from the world? Since we are made up of the same substance of the world, you are made up of the same thing that the world is made of. When you like to grab anything from the world, as if it is an object outside you, you are affecting your very soul, because virtually you are grabbing something from your own self. You are tearing your personality by the insistence that you want something from the world. Because of the fact you cannot stand outside the world, your personality, your psychological alignment get torn to pieces and you become a wretched person because of this habit of wanting things. From whom are you asking things? Who is the giver of it? The giver has substantially stood in the same position as you are. If you are observing a thing, that thing which is observed can also observe you. If a thing is an object before your sense organs, that object with all eyes that it has will look upon you as an object. This is the cause of conflict. Everything is a subject by itself, it is a status that it maintains. Every little thing, even an atom, has a status of its own and it is not an object to be dealt with by somebody else. It refuses to be dealt with even by the very careful eye of a physicist. It eludes the grasp of even the very minute observations and experiments of a laboratory. You cannot grasp it because it is not an object. It stands by itself, as you are also standing by yourself. So if you can gather this information of everything standing by itself and put it in the language of the philosophers, that you can consider everything is an end in itself, the whole world becomes an empire, a kingdom of ends. Nobody, not even a thing in a little broomstick, can be regarded as a means to an end. It has a self-respect. You will be laughing at me, how can a broom have a self-respect? It has. If you are honest enough, you can see how it can speak to you. There was a mystic in Russia who wrote several books, Ouspensky. He was a very psychic person who can feel the vibrations of things outside. He went to a hotel and he saw an ashtray. Where ashes by people who were occupying that hotel had thrown it down. These ashes started speaking to him and he could visualize the form of the people who had thrown the ashes there. The very vibrations cast by the people who occupied that hotel on the walls of the hotel started speaking to this person in the language of the very same people who occupied the house. People say walls have ears, but they have minds also, not merely ears. The wall is not a dead brick. Let not anyone think like that. It can speak to you. It can do what you want. Have you heard of Saint Jnanadeva, who touched a broken wall and he started moving like a motor car. Because consciousness, which was the essence of Saint Jnanadeva, was also the very existence and being of that wall. It was not a wall for him, it was he himself. So when he moved, the wall also moved. And you have heard in the story that Sri Krishna lifted the mountain. He has not lifted any mountain, he has lifted his own hand. Because his subjectivity as Krishna was identical with the subjectivity of the mountain. As an elephant can lift even a heavy leg of itself, while others cannot lift it, because the consciousness of the elephant is identical with the weight of the leg, which others cannot lift. The whole elephant can move. It does not feel its weight, but you cannot make it move, because you are considering it an object. But the elephant is a subject for itself. So in the case with this great cosmic persons like avatars or Krishna, who he did not lift any mountain, he lifted himself only. So there is no wonder in it. As Jnanadeva lifted or moved the wall. You cannot think like this, because you have a disbelief. How could this be? This tree is not me. Nothing is me, I am myself. This myself is a dangerous description of oneself. There is no myself in regard to you, because you have to concede that myself to others also equally. If everybody is a myself, then who is the other in this world? To whom are you referring as an other person? Are you not an other person to other people who are also subjects of you perceiving yourself? Can you not be a little bit of considerate to accept this position that you cannot treat others in the manner quite contrary to the way you are treating yourself? Do unto others as you would be done by Atmana Pratikulani Paresamna Samacharyatu. Do not do to others, do not have an attitude towards others which you do not wish to have towards your own self. How do you deal with yourself? That is the way in which everybody would like to be dealt. Do you know how you deal about yourself? Very interesting. Do you know what you are? What are you thinking about yourself? Can you think about others in the same way as you are thinking yourself? Every little bit, whole creation, you have entered the very foundation of yoga, if this has entered your mind. But, a great but comes. The emotions do not permit this kind of thinking. Because here, in this yogic way of thinking, it is not the mere mind that is operating on a conscious level. Psychologists would have told you that there are levels of mental operation. The level on which we are now operating through the mind is known as conscious mind. But there is a subconscious level. Though consciously you understand something correctly, the subconscious sometimes revolts and says, this is not all right. And psychologists have gone very deep into the levels which are deeper than subconscious, like unconscious, etc. You cannot know your own self because of there being so many layers of your personality in which you are involved, and now you are thinking that what you are able to visualize through the conscious mind is the only thing. The deeper you go into your own self, the deeper also simultaneously you go to the structure of everything else. When you touch the bottom of your personality, you have touched the bottom of everybody else. If you have touched the root of a particular wave in the ocean, you have touched the whole ocean, which is the root of all the waves. Do you understand that? Whole world is touched at one stroke by going deep into yourself. So it is said, know thyself and be free, which is to say, you are free from the opposition that you are facing from the world of objects. When you go deep into your own self, Atmanam Vidhi, know thyself, which means to say the deepest essence or root of yourself, which is identical with the root and essence of everybody else, inanimate or animate, whatever it be. There is no marked distinction between animate and inanimate things. There are only gradations of development. So, moral problems, intellectual doubts should not come in the way of this practice. There are scruples in our minds which are of an inborn nature, introduced into our personality by the cultural background into which we have been born, by the language we are speaking, the country in which we were, the friends that we keep, the books that we study, and all those things influence you. You cannot impersonally think. The human mind, so to say, is a congeries, a muddle of impressions created by various circumstantial facts into which one is born right from childhood. You are more a hodgepodge of impressions created by circumstances outside than a steady-minded, hard, indivisible individual. Everything can disturb your mind. A wisp of wind can disturb you. If the leaf moves, you are disturbed. If somebody looks at you, you are disturbed. If somebody says something, you are disturbed. There is nothing that cannot disturb you. Whole thing is a disturbance, chaos, confusion. You don't know whether it is good to live in the world or not. Such people commit suicide because of the chaos created in their own mind. They don't know themselves, and therefore they cannot do others also. The whole thing is a confusion, muddle, ignorance, mass of ignorance, darkness. This has to be removed gradually by sweeping yourself. The dustbin of the personality of an ordinary individual has to be swept very carefully by investigation, analysis, atma-vichara, as they call it. If you desire the fruits of this wonderful thing called yoga, you cannot have other desires. If you entertain desires contrary to the desire that you are apparently having towards yoga, you will be a hypocrite. A hypocrite is a person who has secretly enshrined in himself a desire for something while openly demonstrating a desire for something else. A kind of conflict between your open behavior and your subtle longings. This will not work. Yoga is not a word that you are uttering. It is an operation of consciousness. And if you have eyes to see, the consciousness also has an eye to see. In fact, it is due to it only that you are able to see things. So your subtle dissipating activities through the conscious mind will be known to the deepest level of yourself. The conflict in your personality will be known to the deepest level of your own being. This is the reason why it is said that whoever is able to take to yoga in right earnest has to be guided by a competent person. A person who has trodden this path can only tell you what are the pitfalls. If you take everything by yourself and imagine that you have got the strength to tread the path, you will not know what is ahead of you, because you will be moving blindfolded, as it were, not knowing what is in front of you. You have to be guarded against the operations of the subconscious and the unconscious levels, who lie in ambush and are ready to attack you in forms that you cannot even decipher. you have heard in the scriptures that God placed serious obstacles before the yoga practitioner. The gods are inside only. I have told you the gods are actually operating superintending principles behind every sensory activity. So, the gods actually are not standing far away in the heavens, in the skies. They are principles behind the activity of our own deepest personality in various ways. So, the obstacles arise, the so-called obstacles in yoga are nothing but the manifestations of potentials of your deepest layer of mind which has not been paid sufficient attention. Just as your conscious mind tells you what you want, the subconscious also says what you want. But you bury that subconscious, do not want to listen to it, and engage yourself entirely with the operation of the conscious mind, and there is a rumbling dissent and an annoyance manifest by the subconscious mind. That is why people who are very rich, very learned, also are unhappy people, because they are appearing to be all right from the conscious level. They have forgotten what is inside their subconscious mind. They are not good psychologists. The rich man is not a good psychologist, nor even a professor. Because they are working on a conscious level, they do not know that they are themselves beneath what they are thinking themselves to be. The potentials which are buried in the subconscious and unconscious level, which look like a huge dark cloud as wide as the sky itself, will prevent you to go further, from going further. These desires are not mere ethereal and vague appearances. They can manifest themselves as actual objects. The gods and goddesses and the obstacles, threats, etc., which you are supposed to be facing in yoga practice, are externalized forms of your own hidden desires. You have not cleansed your mind properly. The gods will not place any obstacle before you if your mind has been cleansed completely, not only of the available conscious desires of the mind, but even the potentials which are possible manifestations in the future. How would you know what are the desires buried in the subconscious level or the unconscious? You will know that if you adopt certain techniques. Now you are in the midst of many people. You are in the family. You are in society. You are in office. The existence of other people condition your mind and you cannot independently think. Suppose, theoretically speaking, for 1 month you sever yourself completely from social contact, go to an unknown place far away somewhere in the height of a mountain in Gangotri or somewhere. Don't talk to any person. Mind your business. And don't say, don't do, don't write letters, don't read books, nothing of the kind. Merely be there for a month, you will find what are your desires. The impression caused by external circumstances in society which press the subconscious and the unconscious deep into their bottom will might manifest themselves gradually when that pressure is lifted. Because nobody is going to talk to you, nobody is going to condition your mind, and you have no harassment from anybody. You yourself are there. Then the submerged potentials of your longings will slowly come up. You will know what are your longings. You will develop silly desires. A little thing will satisfy you. People become kleptomaniacs. A little pencil you pick up and take it. You may be a well-to-do person. Why do you want a pencil of somebody? But kleptomania is the itching of a part of your nervous system agitated by the subconscious and unconscious levels. Even a prince, son of a king, may pick up one little pencil and walk it. This is kleptomania, as they call it, a kind of disease of the mind. You think that you are not at all needing, you will take a money. You will take something from here, like this, whatever, when you go there. Why do you want it? These desires which are looking very funny, obnoxious and silly, they will assume large proportion. You will like to eat more and more. All things will look very delicious. Dry bread will be tasty. Now you won't like to dry bread. He said, why there is no ghee and there is no milk and all that? There, the green leaves will become tasty. People eat green leaves because of the hunger, of the appetite. The appetite is not only the tongue. The whole being is filled with their appetite. The philosophers call it constitutional appetition. The whole constitution is in a state of appetite. It wants to grab, take everything. But because of your confinement to the conscious mind only, this deep grabbing appetite, like a wolf or vulture jumping on things, is pressed down by social circumstance. That is why you look very beautiful before people in society. The social conditions compel you to behave in a particular manner. But when you are alone, there is no such compulsion, the whole devil is come, entire universe, they will come. All the desires which you have not fulfilled in normal life will come out. How do you know what are the desires that you have got so that you may try to fulfill? Great masters have analyzed this situation very well. Psychologists have gone deep into this structure. You may say millions of desires are there. Actually, they are manifestations, ramifications of two or three basic instincts into which we are born. The Upanishads and psychoanalysts also perhaps agree that you have only two or three desires basically. If you boil down all the so-called desires that you are appearing to be having, you will not agree that the desires are only two or three. No, I have got many desires. I like to have many things. These many things are nothing but leaves, branches, twigs and manifestations of a root instinct which manifests itself in one or two or three. One of them is a desire to exist in this body. You will never like to cease to exist in this body. You yourself cannot have an answer to this question. What is it that you are going to acquire by living in this body continuously for eternity? What is it that you are wanting finally? The existence aspect which manifests itself in the love of this body is one of the basic instincts. But simultaneously you are aware this kind of desire is meaningless. It is not possible for a person to exist in this body for indefinite time. There is a desire to exist in this body for eternity if possible. Why should I die? Let me live for long. But the intellect tells you this is not possible because everybody dies, I also will go. So there is a conflict between two feelings in your mind, namely that it is good to live for all time and the feeling that this is not a practicable thing. So you make a compromise between these two things. Let me have some device which is of a compromising nature by which I will be satisfied that I hope to be continuing in my physical life even if this body is going to perish. That desire manifests itself in the desire for progeny. The progeny is loved so much intensely by the parents because the very blood and vein of the parents is moving through the veins of that little child. It is your alter ego, it is you yourself. It is me, the mother says, the father says, my son is me only. So you are satisfied if the son continues to exist, even if your physical body goes, because I am still continuing in the body of another, because it is not another body, the son is me only. People are not satisfied with one son. They want the son of the son also. Otherwise the mind is not satisfied. I want to have a grandchild. I want to see before I die, grandchild must be seen. If the grandchild or another, still more is better. This is the very venomous activity of the otherwise very obnoxious desire, contrary to reality, to perpetuate oneself in the body. And if it is not possible because of the practical conditions, you make yourself believe that you are continuing in the son, in the grandson, and so on and so forth. So this progeny, the desire for progeny, birth of a son, due to which people suffer so much, and oh, they don't know what they are going to do. Anything can be done for the sake of this. But many a time there is a travesty of the desire. It does not actually manifest itself in the birth of a child. It creates only agony, suffering and restlessness throughout life. The kind of which you read in newspapers, how people are caught by this instinct, and while the actual natural instinct is for one thing, actually they are doing something else. So another tragedy over this particular tragedy. So to miss matter, the basic instinct is to exist in the body for all times. Deha vasana, as it is called, which you are trying to bypass by a device that you adopt, by having children, which you consider is enough for you, as good as your own existence. The other desire is name and fame and authority. You do not like to live like a pig having so much progeny. Pigs also have got grandchildren. Would you like to live like them? So you put another condition now. It is not enough if I live like this through children. I want to be a sensible, intelligent, respectable person. Who respects the pig? You just boot it like that. You do not want to live like that. No. I want to live long through, okay, all right, but I want to be a respectable person. People who should adore me, praise me, and I should have also power, authority over others. Because if I have no authority of any kind, I will be just like anybody else from Dick and Harry. Why should I be like anybody else? I am an important man. The desire for importance, recognition, position, authority, power will not leave a person even till the last breath. He would like to die as a major general, not like a beggar. Why should I die like a beggar? I am a retired major general, I am passing you very happily. Don't you think you are a very fortunate person to have died as a big official rather than a poor fellow? Nobody has recognized your existence also. So the desire for name and fame and authority and power also will not leave a person. Apart from the desire to exist physically, the third desire which the Upanishads maintain again and again is the desire to acquire more and more of things, accumulate. Nothing in the world can satisfy you. If you are the owner of a village, we like to have another village also as much as possible. Let me have the other village also. I will extend my empire, you see. Why should I be satisfied with the little district? No, I want to be other districts also. This is the desire of kings, annexion. They annex their kingdom and all. Because the finitude is resented always. You do not like finitude of any kind. You do not like the finitude of our personality and would like to have infinite existence, but you don't like to have finite possession also. I want more and more, more and more, more and more, the entire state and whole country I want. Why whole country? I would like to have other countries also. I will invade other countries and make them my own. The whole earth is mine. Even if the whole earth is mine, I am not satisfied because there is sky. What is there in the sky? I will go to the stars, I will go to the moon, I will go to the Mars. I will possess them also. No, no, endless sky. I go beyond the sky. This desire is due to the basic desire for infinity, which wrongly manifests itself in space and time as a love for possessing more and more things. There is a horizontally manifesting desire to widen one's dimension in this manner, like a king or an emperor, as he feels. The king is an ordinary individual like any one of you. He has not got two heads and 10 eyes. He is just like you, but he thinks he is a very big man. Because he identifies his personal consciousness, finite consciousness, with other things which you think belong to him. So the belonging or the possession of a particular object is considered to be an extension of the dimension of consciousness, while it is a deceit that is played by space and time. The space and time complex will not permit anything to become yours. Nobody can possess anything in this world. Everybody dies like a beggar. That everybody knows. But no, I won't listen to all these things. I want everything. You go on expanding your kingdom, right? Like Muhammad Ghazni went on accumulating, they say. All the gold of the country he took away. And when he was about to pass away, the mountain of gold was in front of him. He was looking at it. Historians say like that, Muhammad Ghazni, he was lying, the last breath was coming, and he saw the whole mountain of gold like this. Going on looking at it and died. This is desire. What is all this? So, desire for name, fame, authority, power. Desire for extending your possessions and becoming the lord of the whole earth, and desire for existence in this body, if it is not possible, you have progeny. There is no other desire in this world. You will find if you boil down all your requirements, all these desires are only three. The instincts are only this much. Dharishana, Viteshana, Lokeshana, as the Upanishad calls it, which I have put in English language for you. It is now time already, nearing 11. I have not touched the yoga. I have only cleared the debris so that you may have no misconceptions in your mind and don't imagine that yoga is a very easy thing. You have to sacrifice your lower instincts and the petty desires in order that you may be blessed by this great, wondrous thing which you are aspiring for. Hari Om Tat Sat.